side of his Son. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, will introduce them to the Father, ransomed, redeemed, and purified, for they were virgins and they walked with the Lamb. I believe in this. I don't believe that the divisions in the church or the false isms that are abroad everywhere will change or hinder the purpose of God. He will have his way in the whirlwind and in the storm, and the clouds will be the dust of his feet. God has also declared that sinners shall be cleansed out of the earth, Psalm 104, verse 35. The sinners are pretty deeply entrenched now. Organized crime in the United States is operating from coast to coast. The criminals are so well organized that the authorities, even the FBI, can't oppose them. If they arrest them, the Supreme Court turns them loose on insufficient evidence. Sin is pretty well entrenched in the world, organized like a cancer that's gone to work on the body of a man. I've heard of cancer spreading throughout a person's body until its roots were everywhere, like an octopus. Of course, that patient didn't last long. If it were not for the sovereign God running his world, the human race couldn't last long. The cancer of iniquity, like some vile disease, has its roots everywhere. But God says that he's going to cleanse sinners out of the earth. There will be new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13. God has ordained that the earth shall be renovated and sinners shall be cleansed away. Nothing and nobody can stop God. You may say, God means well and he has power and authority, but some unforeseen circumstance may derail his plans. But for God there are no unforeseen circumstances. When you start out on a walk down the block, a black cat may run in front of you, a policeman may call you aside, you may drop dead, a car may run up on the sidewalk and break your leg. You never can tell. Unforeseen circumstances are everywhere around you and me, but the sovereign God knows nothing about unforeseen circumstances. He has seen the end from the beginning. He never needs to ask what is in a man. He knows every man. So there can be no unforeseen circumstances. There are also no accidents in God's eyes, because God's wisdom prevents an accident. You may be driving down the highway at 40 miles an hour. A tire blows and you turn over in the ditch. Somebody didn't make that tire quite right and it didn't hang together. I used to make tires in a rubber factory in Akron, Ohio. With some of the workmanship we put into them, it's a wonder they didn't blow out before they got out of the factory. But God Almighty's wisdom never has a blowout. God Almighty knows what he's doing. He's utterly wise, and there can be no accident. Nobody can countermand an order. They say that one of the greatest difficulties during World War II was countermanded orders. They had so many tough generals, Montgomery, Alexander, Eisenhower, and these men were busy. One would give an order, and another would countermand it. You can read accounts of it here and there. One fellow starts doing something and somebody else says, "Just a minute, I got an order from so-and-so canceling that." Then the other fellow would say, "I just got an order from somebody else telling me to do it." Round and round they ran in circles. But I ask you, who can countermand an order given by the great God Almighty? When the sovereign God says it shall be this way, it's that way and nobody can change it. Some may wonder if God might fail because of weakness. But the omnipotent God couldn't be weak because God has all the power there is. H-bombs, cobalt bombs, A-bombs, and all the rest of them, they are nothing. They are the marbles God plays with. God, in his infinite strength, wisdom, authority, and power, is having his way in the whirlwind and the storm. That's what sovereignty means. What does all this mean to you and me? It means that if you walk out of church contrary to the will and way of God, God does not will that you should do it, but he wills that you should be free to do it. And when you freely choose to walk against the way of God, you choose freely to go on the road to perdition. That's one thing about heaven and hell. No one is in either place by accident. Hell is populated by people who chose to go there. They may not have chosen the destination, but they chose the highway. They are there because they love the way that leads to darkness, and they were free to take it because the sovereign God had granted them that much freedom. Everyone in heaven above is there because he chose to go there. No one wakes up to find himself in heaven by accident, saying, I never planned to come here. No. It says that the rich man died, and in hell he lifted up his eyes. The poor, good man died and went to Abraham's bosom. Luke chapter 16, verses 22 through 23. Each of them went where he belonged. When Judas died, he went to his own place. Acts chapter 1, verse 25. And when Lazarus died, he went to his place, places they had chosen. So remember this. Whoever is not on God's side is on the losing side. All of this applies to the matter of consecration and the deeper life of obedience to the Lord. We smile and shrug and make it look as if it was optional, something we could do or not do as we please. But consecration to the will of God is an absolute necessity if you're going to be on God's side. If you're on God's side, you can't lose. If you're on the other side, you can't win. It's as easy as that. No matter how nice we may be, how righteous, how much we give to missions, how moral we are, if we're opposing God, we can't win. But if we surrender and come over to God's side, we can't lose. A man who is with God can't lose because God can't lose. God is the sovereign God who is having his way in the whirlwind and the storm. And when the storm is over and the whirlwind of history has blown itself out, the God who sat on the throne with the rainbow round about it will still be seated on that throne. Beside him will be a ransomed company who chose to go his way. Heaven will not be filled with slaves. There will be no conscripts marching in the armies of heaven. Everyone will be there because he exercised his sovereign freedom to choose to believe in Jesus Christ and surrender to the will of God. I talked to a young man last Sunday night who said something to this effect. I can't say yes to God. I can't surrender. He's a very fine, likable, intelligent young man, but he couldn't say yes to the winning side. So he was saying yes to the losing side. If you say yes to God, you can't lose, and if you say no to God, you can't win. If that's your trouble, you're striving with God. You ask, why don't I get filled with the Holy Ghost? It's because you're striving with God. God wants you to go this way, but you go part way and then veer off. There's always a controversy there between you and God. Are you on God's side, completely holy, forever? Have you given him everything, your home, your business, your school, your choice of a partner in life? Choose Christ's way because Christ is Lord and the Lord is sovereign. It's foolish to choose any other way. It's folly to try to outsmart God, to try to fight against him. Why dost thou strive against him? Job chapter 33, verse 13. Chapter 9. God's Faithfulness. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. Thy faithfulness shalt thou establish in the very heavens, thy faithfulness also in the congregation of the saints. O Lord God of hosts, who is a strong Lord like unto thee, or to thy faithfulness round about thee? But my faithfulness and my mercy shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. Psalm 89, verses 1 through 2, 5, 8, and 24. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 24. God is never out of date. Regardless of the season of the year, it's always proper to preach about God. The faithfulness of God is one of the attributes of the Most High God, whose we are, and whom we claim to serve. The preceding verses are only a few of the texts that say that God is faithful. I intend to define faithfulness and then try to apply it and show what it means to us now. Faithfulness is that in God which guarantees that he will never be or act inconsistent with himself. You can put that down as an axiom. It is good for you now, and good for you when you're dying. It will be good to remember as you rise from the dead, and good for all the eons and millenniums to come. God will never cease to be what he is and who he is. Everything God says or does must be in accord with his faithfulness. He will always be true to himself, to his works, and to his creation. God is his own standard. God imitates nobody and is influenced by nobody. That may be hard to take in this degenerate age, when we've introduced the idea of the VIP, the man of influence. And they say, crudely enough, it isn't what you know, it's who you know. But you can't influence God one way or another. And God imitates nobody. He is never forced to act out of character. Nothing can force God to act otherwise than faithfully to himself and to us. No person, no circumstance, nothing. If I can imagine someone who can influence God strongly enough to change his mind or compel him to do anything that he hadn't planned to do, or be anything that he isn't, then I am thinking of someone greater than God, which is obvious nonsense. Who can be greater than the greatest, higher than the highest, or mightier than the mightiest? The faithfulness of God guarantees that God will never cease to be who and what he is, just as his immutability guarantees that. You may remember what I said about the immutability of God, that if God changed in any way, he'd have to change in one of three directions, from better to worse, from worse to better, or from one kind of being to another. Because God is absolutely perfectly holy, he couldn't be anything less than holy, so he couldn't change from better to worse. And God couldn't get any holier than he is, so he couldn't change from worse to better. Also, God, being God and not a creature, could not change the kind of being that he is. God's perfection secures this. God's faithfulness also secures it. Because God can never cease to be who he is and what he is. Now, that may sound a little dry, but if you get that inside of you and build on it, you'll be glad you know it the next time you're in a tough circumstance. You can live on froth and bubbles and little wisps of badly understood theology until the pressure is on, and when the pressure is on, you'll want to know what kind of God you're serving. This is the kind of God you're serving. All that God says or does must accord with all of his attributes, including his attribute of faithfulness. Every thought that God thinks, every word that God speaks, every act of God must accord with his faithfulness, wisdom, goodness, justice, holiness, love, truth, and all his other attributes. To magnify one phase of God's unitary character and diminish another is always wrong. The man of God who stands in the pulpit ought always to correct this error as far as he can. He ought to see to it that we see God full-rounded in all of his perfection and glory. If we magnify one attribute to the diminishing of another, we have an asymmetrical concept of God, a lopsided God. That is, he is lopsided as we see him. If you look at a tree, standing straight and tall, through the wrong kind of lens, you'll see it crooked. And you can see God crooked, but the crookedness is in your eye, not in God. For instance, if we make our God to be all justice, then we have a God of terror, and we flee from him in fright. There was a time when the church swung over to hell, judgment, sin, and all that. We rather tremble when we think of how the church went through this period, when about all she talked about was the justice of God. God was looked upon as a tyrant and the universe as a kind of totalitarian state, with God at the top, ruling with a rod of iron. If we think only of the justice of God, that's the concept we'll have. Then, over on the other side, as a reaction from that, came the time when we only thought about God as being love. God is love, 1 John chapter 4, verse 16, is our main text now. We no longer have a God of terror, but a sentimental, spineless God, the God of the Christian Scientist. God is love, and love is God, and all is love, and all is God, and God is all. Pretty soon we haven't got a thing left. It's like the cotton candy that you buy at the circus. All you have is sweetness and nothing but sweetness. We've magnified the love of God without remembering that God is just. Or if we make God all good, then we have the weak sentimentalist of the modernist and the liberal. The God of the liberal and the modernist is not the God of the Bible, because in order to get the God they get, they have to get rid of almost everything God did in the Old Testament. God couldn't make the sun stand still, and he couldn't send fire on Sodom and Gomorrah. They say that was just nature. God couldn't send a worldwide flood upon the ungodly. They say that was just a little flood, like they had in Texas some time back. So in order to make room for a God that's nothing but good, that just sits up there in a great glob of goodness, they had to get rid of almost everything God ever did by way of justice. If we make him a God of grace and nothing else, as gospel churches have over the past 50 years, we have a God who cannot see moral distinctions. That is why the church has been unable to see moral distinctions. Instead of a separated holy church, we have a church that's so geared into the world you can't tell one from the other. It was said of a certain great English preacher that he preached grace in such a manner as to lower the moral standards of England. It's entirely possible to preach grace in the church until we become as arrogant and brazen as can be, forgetting that grace is one of the attributes of God, but not all. While God is a God of grace, he is also a God of justice, holiness, and truth. Our God will always be true to his nature because he is a faithful God. Faithlessness is one of the greatest sources of heartache and misery in all the world. God will never be faithless. He cannot be. Back in the book of Genesis, it says, Noah builded an altar unto the Lord, and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake. For the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more everything living, as I have done. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. Genesis chapter 8, verses 20 through 22. Therefore, don't pay a bit of attention to these people who are saying that the world is going to be swept off the earth with an atom bomb or a hydrogen bomb. Pay no attention to warnings that the human race is going to be annihilated. God says, while the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. Chapter 8, verse 22. And I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake. Chapter 8, verse 21. God has said it here. Further along it says, And God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And I, behold, I establish my covenant with you, and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you. From all that go out of the ark, to every beast of the earth, and I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood. Neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And it shall come to pass, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud. And I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth. Chapter 9, verses 8 through 11, and verses 14 through 16. God wrote that long before they made that little bomb over there at the University of Chicago. God made that covenant before man made science. And I'm perfectly restful in that covenant. I do not expect my children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, or great-great-grandchildren to cease to be. And I don't expect them to turn into green men with one eye in the middle of their forehead. I expect God to fulfill his promise because God can't help but do it. God must be true to himself, and when God makes a promise, he must keep that promise. God made this promise unconditionally, and will see to it that it stands. We will continue to have summer and winter. We won't have Florida weather all over the world. We will always have snow in the winter. God said that summer and winter, harvest and springtime will always be here, so you can expect that. God said it, and I believe it. God says in the Psalms that He hath remembered His covenant forever, the word which He commanded to 1,000 generations, Psalm 105, verse 8. And our Lord said, Till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled, Matthew chapter 5, verse 18. You can count on that. That is the fact before us. God is faithful. He will remain faithful because He cannot change. He is perfectly faithful because God is never partly anything. God is perfectly all that He is and never partly what He is. You can be sure that God will always be faithful. This faithful God who never broke a promise and never violated a covenant, who never said one thing and meant another, who never overlooked anything or forgot anything, is the Father of our Lord Jesus and the God of the Gospel. This is the God we adore and the God we preach. God's faithfulness to sinners. Let us now look at God's faithfulness in its application. As it applies to sinners, if you are lost and you know it, God has declared that He will banish from His presence all who love sin and reject His Son. God has promised that. He has declared that. He has warned and threatened, and it will be so. Let no one trust a desperate hope, for it is based on the belief that God threatens but doesn't fulfill. No, God waits that He may be gracious. And He will sometimes postpone in order to give us another 30 days, another 60 days, to make up our minds. But just as sure as the mills of God grind, the souls of men fall into them and are ground exceedingly small. God moves slowly and is very patient. But God has promised that He will banish from His presence all who love sin, who reject His Son and refuse to believe. That is the message for the sinner who won't come, who loves his sin. But there's another kind of sinner that the old writers call the returning sinner. The ultimate example in the Bible of a returning sinner is, of course, the prodigal son. Do you remember what that boy said? Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. Luke chapter 15, verse 12. He wanted his part of the will before the old man had died, and his father gave it to him. He took it and left, and when he came down to nothing, he started back. Now there's a returning sinner. He's still a sinner. He still has his rags on him. He still smells of the swine pen. But he's a returning sinner. And our Lord calls returning sinners, Come unto me. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. The promises and invitations of the Lord are as valid as the character of God. D.L. Moody found that if he offered a poor child $1, the child would often back off and refuse to take it. He didn't trust Moody strongly enough to believe that Moody expected the child to take it. When God promises anything, you may be sure that God expects to do it. But we in the church have gotten so we scarcely believe anything at all. Even Martha believed that her brother would rise again on the last day, although she didn't believe that the Lord would raise him right then, John chapter 11, verse 24. We too put off everything into the future, and then we call it eschatology. That's a big word for unbelief, you know. I suppose to be perfectly right about it, I ought to say that eschatology is a theological word for end-time things. But I have noticed that eschatology is a dustbin into which we sweep everything we don't want to believe. We believe in miracles, but we believe in them eschatologically. That is, they'll happen way out there sometime. We believe that the Lord will heal the sick, but He'll do it way out there. We believe that the Lord will manifest Himself to men, but He'll do it tomorrow, or the day after, or next millennium. And so we sweep it under the rug and go on about our business. That's eschatology. We believe that God will bless the Jews in the days to come. I have noticed that some Christians are getting away from that now. They don't believe in any future for Israel. But I do. We believe that the Lord will bless the church sometime when he comes back again. But the idea of his blessing anybody now? We have a tough time believing that. I said in a sermon one time that unbelief is one of the slickest things in the world. Unbelief always says, somewhere else, but not here. Some other time, but not now. Some other people, but not us. That's unbelief. We fight for the miracles of the Old Testament, but won't believe in a miracle happening today. We believe in miracles tomorrow or yesterday, but we stand in a gap between miracles. I believe that if we had faith, we'd see miracles now, though I don't believe we ought to celebrate miracles by putting up big tents and advertising that we're going to have a miracle. I don't believe in advertising miracles because God isn't going to allow himself to be advertised. God doesn't have a going-out-of-business sale. The Lord never gives cheap miracles. He never exposes his glorious, mysterious will to please the carnal saintlings. But the Lord is perfectly willing to do the impossible when his people dare to believe that he is a faithful God and meant what he said. Yet we don't take God at his word at all. But if you are a returning sinner, and you leave your old rags behind you and come to the Lord, you'll find that when the Lord said, "Come unto me, and I will give you rest," Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, he meant exactly that. Frances Havergal said that she came to a spot where she believed that the Lord meant exactly what he said. When he said, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness," 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. She found out that the Lord meant exactly what he said. Why don't you start reading your Bible with the thought that God meant exactly what he said there? We're getting so many translations now, but I find they add up to about the same thing. It's one of the biggest fallacies, one of the biggest delusions possible to imagine that if you get it said another way, it will mean more. People imagine that if they get a new translation that tells them a little better what it means, it will be wonderful. Actually, it will simply be a big disappointment. I know because I am the prime sucker for a new translation. Every time one comes out, I run and get it. I hopped down to the bookstore the other day and bought the latest New Testament. It's all right, but it doesn't give me any more faith. It doesn't make God any more real, and it doesn't bring heaven any closer. Anyway, when you read your Bible, instead of wondering about it, say to yourself, God wrote this, and God is faithful. God cannot lie. For example, read 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanseth us from all sin. That's a heartening and wonderful truth, if you are a Christian who may have sinned. I have heard people say, I don't believe in sinning Christians. I don't either. But I meet a lot of them. I don't think Christians ought to sin, and I don't think we ought to make light of it. I think that when a Christian sins, they're doing a deadly, dangerous, and terrible thing. But I also know that the Holy Ghost said, My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. And he also said, If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Chapter 1, verse 9. Now here's something you may have never noticed. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God promised he would forgive, and he is faithful to do so. But it says he is faithful and just to forgive. Justice is on our side now. Instead of justice being against us and grace being for us, the blood of Jesus Christ works such an amazing wonder before the throne of God and before the presence of man that now justice has come over on the side of the returning sinner. And when the sinner comes home, there isn't a thing standing between him and the very heart of God. It's all been swept away by the blood of the Lamb. So if any old memories back in your mind, or the devil, or some preacher, tells you that justice is against you, remember that the Scriptures